Greetings from the Asian Productivity Organization Secretariat. Welcome to all viewers to the APO Productivity Talk, which is a series of discussion on the topics related to productivity. Our discussion here today is energy solutions for green productivity. Energy solutions are one of the key areas we all need to look at to overcome challenging environmental issues, such as global warming and climate change. The corporate world now sees cleaner, greener, eco-friendly fuels and technologies as an opportunity for improvement and long-term sustainable growth. No business that strives to remain competitive and open to new markets and opportunities can afford to ignore the global demand for improved environmental performance of products and services. So in this productivity talk, we'll share insights on the importance of energy efficiencies and renewable energy, which are not only to help industry save energy and money, but also to achieve green productivity, a concept developed by the APO as a strategy for enhancing productivity while improving environmental performance. We'll also discuss energy solutions for industries to reinforce sustainable development efforts through superior product quality, improved environmental quality, greater human safety and security, and a better quality of life. To discuss about this important topic, we're joined today by Mr. Joel Franklin Azaria from Chennai, India. Greetings from Tokyo, Joel.
Greetings, Mayu. Thank you very much for your kind invitation to join this productivity talk. It's my great pleasure to be here now.
We are glad to have you here today for this productivity talk. As a brief introduction, Joel is a Senior Deputy Director at the National Productivity Council India. He has 20 years of experience in energy and environmental and renewable energy areas. He holds a Bachelor of Technology degree in Chemical Engineering, Master's of Science in Ecology and Environment, Master's in Engineering, and Master's in Business Administration. Joel is a gold medalist in energy engineering, as well as a certified energy auditor of India, certified quality management system auditor, and certified lead auditor. Now, I would like to invite Joel for his presentation and sharing. Joel, please.
So thank you, Mayu, for your kind introduction about me. And good morning and good afternoon to everyone who is with us now. So we are going to discuss on energy solutions like energy efficiency and renewable energy technologies to achieve green productivity. So before we discuss on various energy solutions, let us first understand the basic concepts of productivity and green productivity. So productivity is a measure of how effectively and efficiently resources are utilized to produce goods and services needed by the society. In broad sense, productivity is a measure of output and inputs. So output is a single factor, whereas inputs are many factors like capital, labor, energy, material, and services. So we must reduce the input factor to increase our output. So we have energy and material as our input factors. So effective and efficient use of energy and material will lead to less amount of undesirable waste. Otherwise, it will cause environmental pollution. So conventional productivity, it talked only about how to increase productivity, but due attention has not been given for environmental compliance. The green productivity concept emerged in early 1990s when people started to realize that emphasizing productivity and economic growth alone may lead to irreversible environmental damage. So green productivity is a strategy for enhancing productivity as well as improving environmental performance for overall social economic development. So productivity is nothing but increasing our desirable output by reducing our undesirable input as well as output. So the main objective of green productivity is to improve environmental protection and to improve productivity enhancement through sustainable and continuous improvements. So NPC along with APO has been doing a similar concept for over the many years, like pollution prevention, waste minimization, cleaner production, eco efficiency, and so on. So industrial facilities use energy basically in three forms. One is as electricity, the second one is as heating, and the third one is for cooling for their production process and the operation of other utilities. In total cost of industries, 30% comes from energy cost alone. So industries that use energy in more efficient and effective manner only can survive in the future global markets, and they will be sustainable only if they go for more efficient and cost effective technologies. So there are various benefits when you go for energy efficiency. It reduces waste, it reduces your energy cost, it improves your quality, it will increase your productivity and profits, it will increase your competitiveness, it will reduce your environmental damage, and it will ensure energy security and finally lead to sustainable development. So world rely mostly on fossil fuels. This usage of fossil fuels will damage our environment. Not only that, these fossil fuels are depleting in nature. So there are only two solutions left for us. One is either we have to improve our energy efficiency of systems like buildings, transportation system, industry, electrical system, or we need to go for alternate energy sources like solar, wind, biomass, geothermal, and other storage technologies. So there are best global practices and energy solutions for industrial, electrical, and thermal systems. For industrial electrical system, we have solutions like energy efficient motors, VFD technologies for driven systems like fans, pumps, compressors, high efficient chillers, IoT based applications. For thermal systems, we have energy solutions like pressure reducing turbine, heat pump, heat pipe, condensing boiler, absorption chillers, trigeneration, and organic Rankine cycle. So these solutions we will discuss one by one in detail with case example in my subsequent slides. The first one is electric motors. So about 70% of equipment used in industry and buildings are powered by electric motors. So operating cost of industrial motors is very, very important, because the operating cost is 100 times its purchase cost. Your purchase cost will be just 2%, remaining 98% goes for operating of these motors. So for the lifetime of 15 to 20 years, if you calculate operating cost, it is very much higher than your purchase cost. So one must be very careful in selecting a good and right size and high efficient motors. Typically, applications include fans, pumps, compressor, and air conditioners. These are driven systems by electric motor. So about 10% of energy can be saved by replacing old inefficient motors with this new energy efficient motors. In 2008, International Electrotechnical Commission, that is IEC, they came up with standards IEC 60034-30 for efficient motors. So there are many categories: IE1, IE2, IE3, IE4 and IE5. So these categories are based on efficiency. IE5 is the highest efficient motor according to these standards. So this is a case study we executed in a process industry where 110 kilowatt motor, which is of IE2 efficiency, 94.5% efficiency motor was used for the requirement. Because it has crossed more than 15 years of its lifetime, and the efficiency was also very, very less. So we recommended to replace it with the latest high efficient motor of efficiency 95.4%. So the energy saved by replacing with the new efficient motor is 0.82 kilowatt. So it was operated for 8000 hours. The annual energy saving is 6589 units of electricity. The corresponding annual cost savings is $630. The purchase cost of IE2 was $4200 and IE3 motor was $4850. The premium price, that is $650, was required in less than 1 year, because the savings is $630 and the investment is just $650 for purchasing this new energy efficient pump. So we could require the premium price within a year. The next one is variable frequency technology. So this technology is based on affinity loss. So the affinity loss, there are power variations by varying your speed. And power varies along with the speed of your motor. So when compared to other parameters, power varies drastically with change in speed. So if speed is increased by 10%, your power will be increased by 33%. So when you find huge load variations in your process where you are applying motors, so you can think of applying this variable frequency drive technology. So the speed reduction depend on the characteristics of load being driven by this motor. There are three types of load: constant torque load, example are centrifugal pumps and fans; variable torque loads, we have agitators, grinders and other positive displacements equipments. Then these two technologies can go for VFD. So VFD is applicable for these two types of loads, whereas constant power load, it is not applicable. VFD is suitable only for variable torque loads and constant torque loads, and constant power loads we cannot use this VFD technology. The next one is chillers. In industries, we use chillers for our cooling requirements, and the efficiency over a period of 20 years has undergone tremendous improvement due to innovations. So the chillers, which have crossed more than 20 years of their lifetime and running for about 1000 years in a year, and it requires high maintenance, those chillers can be considered for replacement with high efficient chillers, whereby we can save 40% of your energy. And also IoT based chillers. In IoT based chillers, the sensors monitor all the parameters like inlet and outlet temperatures of water, then space temperature, ambient temperature. So accordingly, it will set your chiller water temperature to save energy. So next one is thermal energy solutions. So far we have discussed on various energy solutions for electrical systems in industries. Now we will move on to thermal energy solutions for industrial applications. The first one is pressure reducing turbine. So in industries we use steam for our process requirements. So this case example is based on one of our case studies in process industries. So about 3 tons per hour of steam was used for their heating requirements. It was taken from main steam of 10.5 kg pressure, but the actual requirement is 3.5 kg pressure to meet their heating requirements. For controlling the pressure, they were using pressure reducing valve. It is the simple technique. Simply you can control your steam pressure with the help of pressure reducing valve. This pressure reducing valve not only reduces your pressure from 10.5 to 3.5 kg, but there is a huge energy loss. It is an inefficient way of controlling your steam. Instead, if you replace this pressure reducing valve with pressure reducing turbine, so it is otherwise called micro turbine, so you not only you get reduced pressure for your requirement, but also you can generate free power using this micro turbine. In this case, we recommended the unit to go for a micro turbine of 40 kilowatt size. The operating hours is 8400. The annual energy saving is around 302400 units of electricity. The annual cost saving is $28,000, whereas the investment for this micro turbine was $48,000. So that was required within 2 years of time. The next energy solution is heat pump. So the heat pumps works just opposite to your refrigeration cycle. It has also evaporator, compressor, liquefier and expansion valve. So here it applies a special refrigerant. It takes away the heat from your atmosphere, which is at low temperature. It uses low grade heat and delivers at high temperature for the space heating. So it is used for space heating purposes and space conditioning in hotels, malls, theaters and other commercial buildings. Industrial applications include dairy, pharma sector, textile, food industries, automobile sector, boiler feed water preheating and other drying applications. They can be used at temperatures ranging from minus 100 degree to 100 plus 100 degree centigrade. The next one is a case study to replace electric heaters with a heat pump. So this study was conducted by us in auto component manufacturing sector. So we recommended to go for heat pump for washing of their auto components. They were using electric heater to meet their hot water requirements. So their hot water temperature requirement is 55 to 60 degree centigrade. So the hot water was produced with the help of electric heaters. The capacity of electric heater was 72 kilowatt, but we recommended to replace it with the heat pump. So the heat pump can generate hot water of 60 degree centigrade, but the power requirement for the heat pump is only 28 kilowatt. The annual energy saving by replacing the electric heater with heat pump is 80,000 units. The corresponding annual cost saving is $7,567. The investment required for replacement is $50,000. So we could require our investment within 2 years of time. So this is the system. You can see it in the figure. So industrial pump takes the low heat from the atmosphere and it delivers high temperature. It is stored in buffer tank and it supplies heat to two locations where washing machines are used for washing of auto components. The next thermal energy solution is heat pipe. So heat pipe is a tube connected at both the ends. This is also a waste heat recovery equipment which requires low grade heat and the technology is based on evaporation and condensation cycle. The refrigerant, that is working fluid, it boils by absorbing the waste heat and becomes vapor. The vapors migrate to the other end of the tube, where it becomes liquid by delivering the heat, absorbed heat, to the end use. So this can be used for control panel cooling, plastic mold cooling, rectifier cooling, and gearbox cooling. So this replaces rotary regenerator in thermal power plants. The next one is condensing boiler. In standard boiler, we burn fuel and we get steam, and the combustion products are discharged into the atmosphere. So the combustion products are called flue gases, which are at high temperatures. So they try to require this high temperature, and waste is available from the flue gas with the help of economizers and air preheaters. In condensing boiler type, the flue gas which was coming out from the boiler at 400 degree centigrade, so it is used for boiler preheating by installing different economizers and condensing unit at different stages. So the first, the initial flue gas, which is at 330 degree centigrade, is made to lose its heats, and amount of heat is required, and the flue gas leaves the first stage with 175 degree centigrade, and it enters to the second stage, where again it is cooled to 85 degree centigrade, and there also some amount of waste heat is required. The finally, in the final stage, 85 degree centigrade is further brought down to 50 degree centigrade by condensing unit, where the water vapors are condensed to liquid condensate, and the heat also required. So in this condensing boiler, the vapors from hydrogen in the fuel and moisture in the fuel and air in the fuel, sorry, water in the fuel, so all these will become water vapor by absorbing heat from the fuel energy. So the energy which used for hydrogen and moisture in the air and moisture in the fuel was not used for generating steam. Whereas this condensing boiler not only helps to require the water vapor, but also it completely requires your heat, waste heat. So by doing this, the thermal efficiency of your boiler improves, and also there will be a reduction in fuel consumption and water also required. The next one is absorption chillers. So these absorption chillers use heat instead of electricity. So this heat we can supply with the help of waste heat from our industries, like low pressure steam, or we can integrate this one with the solar based thermal systems. So the solar based thermal systems also supply heat steam which is required for this absorption chiller system. The next one is dry generation system. So in this system, from a single input of fuel energy, we can get three outputs. One is electricity, and the next one is chilled water, and the third one is hot water. So we get cooling, heating, and electricity from fuel energy. So this case study tells about a gas engine which was used in a process industry for generating electricity. So the electricity is generated from the gas engine, and the flue gas is generated at 400 degree centigrade, which was let into atmosphere, and also water was used to cool the engine circuit, that was also wasted. So we recommended the unit to go for variable vapor absorption machine for cooling applications, and also the water, hot water available from the engine cooling circuit for heating applications like kitchen, laundry, and other purposes. So the engine capacity was 347 kilowatt engine. The energy savings was 660,000, that is 660,000 units per annum. The investment required in less than 3 years of time. The next one is organic Rankine cycle. So in traditional Rankine cycle, water is used to generate electricity, and we are using only steam based turbines. So in this technology, we use organic fluid which become vapor at low temperature and low pressures. So it can be used as heat recovery equipment for low temperature sources from 90 to 300 degrees centigrade. For heat requirements, we can go for biomass or solar heating, and we can supply heat for the organic fluid. It becomes vapor, and this runs the turbine, we get electricity. So far we have discussed on many energy efficient solutions for industrial and thermal applications. Now we move on to other alternative energy sources. So the usage of fossil fuels damage the environment. So all nations have decided to reduce the usage of fossil fuels, and they started searching for alternate energy sources. And out of other alternate energy sources, renewable energy sources have huge capacity to meet our energy requirements. So out of renewable energy sources like wind, solar, hydro, biomass, geothermal, wave, tidal, and ocean thermal energy conversion, wind, solar, hydro, biomass are widely used. First, we'll start with wind energy applications for industries. So this technology is not a new technology. So people were using wind power for milling grains and water lifting purposes in 9th century itself. The first electricity producing machine came in 1891. The wind technology is a matured and well proven technology, and it reduces greenhouse gas emissions, and it doesn't require any water, and it is eco-friendly and green energy. It doesn't require much space also, because the land below the wind turbine can be used for other purposes and other agricultural activities. The gestation period to set up a wind turbine is also very, very less. In wind turbine technology, the kinetic energy available in the wind is converted into mechanical energy, and mechanical energy is converted into electrical energy. So the conversion efficiencies from kinetic to mechanical, the rotor efficiency is around 45 to 52%, and in gearbox the efficiency is 95 to 97%, and in generator the efficiency is 90 to 95%. So according to Betts limit, the theoretical maximum efficiency of a wind turbine is only 50%. So at present condition, the wind turbines are working with efficiency of around 45%. So in wind turbine, we have many components. The important components here you can see in the figure. It has a hub. The nose part is called hub with rotor blades. Then this portion is called nacelle, which houses gearbox, generator, and other electrical controls. Then this is the tower, and we have foundation at the bottom. The power from the wind depends mainly on density of air and swept area and wind velocity. So the power in wind is half rho a v cube. Rho is density, a is swept area, and v is the velocity of wind. So we have no control over velocity of wind, but if the density is high, we will get more power from the wind, and also swept area. In the figure, you can see the rotor blade diameter. This circle is your swept area, where the wind intercept the blades. So if you increase the length of the blade, so that to increase swept area, definitely you will get more power from the wind. So other applications of wind energy, we can use it for water pumping. So in India, we use this wind pumps for watering of crops. It has many blades because it has to generate more torque to lift the water from the borewell. So the pump is piston type. The rotary motion of windmill is converted into to and fro motion, so that the piston can move up and down and suck the water from the underground borewell. So it can be stored in the overhead tank and it can be used. So these are the various parameters, you can see dimensions. So for windmill to work, we should have at least 3 to 5 meters per second of wind in that particular site, and the water table and the height of the overhead tank should be within 100 meters, and other height of the tower, you can see 9 to 23 meters. So for all industrial watering agricultural purpose in India, we installed so many windmills. The next one is solar energy. So we have a huge potential, and this energy is evenly distributed everywhere. So we will get solar radiations everywhere, and also we get solar radiation for more number of days. This is also clean energy, green energy, and the gestation period is also very, very less. We can use the solar for generation of electricity as well as for thermal applications. The applications include thermal for water heating, drying, cooking applications, oven, space heating, and electricity generation commercial scale using solar concentrating techniques, and direct electricity from PV technology. So solar PV technology has a semiconductor based solar system. It will convert the photons energy from solar radiations into electricity. The electricity is in DC form. So we use a converter to convert this DC electricity into AC electricity to meet our load requirements. This can be supplied to grid. So if you go for megawatt scale solar PV technology, the power can be fed into the electricity grid with the help of net meters. So this net meter records the how much units is pumped to the grid. In solar roof system, we have two types. One is a grid tied system. So in grid tied system, the electricity which is generated from the solar PV is taken through an inverter, so that the DC becomes AC. So the AC is directly fed to the grid. Suppose if there is a problem with renewable source, that is solar energy, then in that case you can take electricity from grid also to meet your load requirements. The only disadvantage of this system is it will work only there is a power in the grid. The next one is off grid PV plant. So it works independent of your power grid. So here also electricity which is generated from PV system, it is in DC form. With the help of charge controller, it is fed to your battery bank. So the purpose of charge controller here is it will save the battery from overcharging. The stored DC can be used for our DC loads, and the AC also can directly be used for to meet our AC loads. So it can be used to meet both AC and DC loads. So sometimes we can have a DG set also for backup purpose. The industrial uses include hospitals, educational institutions, government offices, commercial buildings, construction companies, telecommunication towers, and petrol pumps. So these plants are mainly used for electricity, lighting, and pumping purposes. Solar water applications. We have a flat plate which can supply hot water up to 80 degrees centigrade. We can use it for domestic applications to meet our hot water and bathing applications. Evacuated tube. It can supply hot water with higher temperatures up to 200 degrees centigrade. We can use it for washing purposes and also for boiler feed water preheating purposes. Parabolic dish, which can supply hot water and steam at higher temperatures up to 400 degrees centigrade. So this can be used for commercial power generation purposes. Parabolic trough can go up to 550 degrees centigrade. So this will also be used for commercial scale power generation using solar concentrating techniques. Parabolic trough power plant. So in this power plant, we have parabolic troughs, concave troughs. So it will absorb solar radiations and focus to the focal line at the center. At the center, we have absorbers in which the circulation medium, heat transfer medium, circulated. So it takes the heat and the heat is stored and it is used for generating electricity. So we can get up to 550 degree centigrade high temperatures using this parabolic troughs. In industries, they are used for power generation, solar cooling, milk pasteurization, boiler feed water preheating, process heat requirements. Solar power tower, it has a receiver tank at the top of the tower, and with the help of many heliostats, the solar radiations are made to concentrate at the receiver tank, which has a heat transfer medium. It takes the heat, and heat is stored in thermal energy storage tanks for up to 17 hours. So whenever required, so it is made to run the turbine and generate electricity. With the help of 1 square kilometer land, this power tower can generate 300 gigawatt units of power. So this is almost equal to 50 megawatt thermal power system based on coal and other gas. So other solar applications are street lighting, solar electricity based coolers, and solar pump. It is like wind pump. This can also be used for agricultural purposes. So in India, this is already in place. So with the help of solar PV system, the electricity is generated, and this electricity is used to run around half HP up to 5 HP pumps which uses water to pump from the borehole, and the water is used for agriculture purposes. So this pump can deliver 65,000 liters per day with the help of 900 watts panel, and 135,000 liters per day with the help of 1800 watts panel from a depth of 7 meters on a clear sunny day. Other thermal applications of solar for industry: we have cooling applications and heating applications. In cooling applications, the absorption chillers require waste heat. Here we can integrate with the solar thermal system, which can supply hot water or steam required by absorption chillers. So in heating system, again we can use solar thermal system, which can generate hot water at 60 to 70 degree centigrade. That can be used as a boiler feed water to meet industrial processes. So, micro and small enterprise require very less amount of power in the range of 20 to 30 kilowatt. So these small industries can go for solar based electricity. So here you can see the small machine used for incense sticks manufacturing. It is based on solar electricity. Solar electricity based tricycle and liquid filler and auger filler machines also use solar electricity, and spinning unit is also based on solar electricity, and many sealing units, they operate based on solar electricity. Food industries, we have micro milling unit based on solar electricity, and dryers for food products also use solar electricity and solar flat plate collectors. Vegetable cutting machines, wet grinders, they are also based on solar electricity. Other agricultural applications: fodder machines, fruit graders, grading machines, all are based on solar electricity. So bioenergy, it is versatile in nature, and it is the only energy from which we can get solid, gaseous and liquid fuels through direct combustion, biomethanation, gasification and esterification processes. Wherever we use fossil fuels for our heating requirements, we can replace fossil fuels with bioenergy based fuels. We can use biofuels for hot air generators, drying applications. Instead of fossil fuel, we can use it for boilers, thermic fluid heaters, cooking bioethanol, we can use it for transportation. Textile units, for their heating requirements, they were using hot water and steam. So originally they were using firewood to meet their heating requirements. Now the firewood is replaced with biogas based heating equipments. So bioelectricity is produced from agricultural waste through gasification process. The waste becomes producer gas of high calorific value, which is made to run internal combustion engine, where mechanical power is converted through electricity with the help of generator. So bioelectricity, we can use it for pumping and irrigation purposes, because in agricultural field we have a huge amount of biomass, so we can use this biomass to generate electricity and use it for pumping and irrigation purposes. We can use it for village electrification. We can use it for captive power requirements. This is a biomethanation plant. It is in my place, Chennai, India, where vegetable waste is used to generate gas, and the gas is used to generate electricity. So the market was generating about 100 tons per day of vegetable waste. So this biomethanation plant engine capacity is 250 kilowatt. So this engine uses 30 tons of vegetable waste and generates 200 units of electricity. There are many integration approaches where you can integrate many renewable energy sources to meet our local requirement, and this system will generate continuous and reliable power. So in these photographs you can see, for street lighting also, small wind turbine coupled with the solar PV panel. And sometimes these hybrid systems will have battery backup and connected with the DG also. Sometimes if renewable are not helping, they can run with battery or DG set. So electricity by its nature cannot be stored as electricity, but it can be converted into other forms like mechanical, thermal, chemical, electrochemical through pump storage, compressed air, energy storage, flywheels, thermal systems. We have sensible and latent thermal storage techniques. Under chemical, we have hydrogen gas storage systems. Electrochemical, we have lithium ion battery, lead acid battery, sodium sulfate based battery, redox flow batteries, and super capacitors also we use. So through this technology we convert electricity into other forms, and we can use for our future requirements. Out of these storage systems, batteries are very flexible and widely used. So among various batteries also, lead acid batteries are widely used. So the only problem with lead acid batteries, it is not eco-friendly because of lead, which is toxic. So lot of innovations are happening in lithium ion battery. The lithium ion battery is eco-friendly. It's a green battery. It has high power density, and also the maintenance is very less. It requires less space. So lithium ion battery is our future battery technology. So with this, let us all join our hands together to create green earth. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Joel, for your very informative presentation. Let's now move on to the discussion and questions. So the first question that I have, you have discussed many energy solutions for green productivity. What are the key challenges faced by SMEs in introducing these solutions? How can they overcome these challenges?
The key challenges of SMEs are lack of knowledge and awareness about these solutions, whatever we discussed today, and also financial constraints. So the economy may be a little bit low because of COVID situation now, but definitely the economy will gradually boost. The maximum investment that is going to happen in the world in the next 20 to 25 years of time will be mainly on energy area. The developing world, which is 2/3 of the world, as they are going to be developing, so the main driver will be energy for their sustainable development. And also there are green funds available from international financial corporations, so SMEs can make use of these green funds for their future development.
Thank you. Okay, now this question is on the renewable technology you have shared in the slides. Although the renewable technology you discuss are suitable for SMEs, they are mainly intermittent. So how can the issues of intermittence be addressed? Can you please elaborate?
So we must agree the fact that the renewable energy sources are intermittent because we get solar power only when sun shines and we get wind power only when there are enough strong winds. So to overcome this situation, there's a technique called hybridization, which is nothing but combining two renewable energy sources into one. And by combining these two technologies, we can get continuous and reliable power supply. So this technique also incorporates battery backup and DG set. Suppose the renewables are not helping due to bad weather condition, so we can get power from a battery system from the storage. And also if battery runs low, we can get power with the help of DG set. So this hybridization taps multiple energy sources and ensure continuous power supply.
Thank you very much. Now I'd like to look at from the different angle, from a policy perspective. What types of government support are offered in India to help SME to introduce renewable energy? Could you kindly share with us?
So in India, SMEs consume more than 50% of energy, that is around 60 million ton of oil equivalent of energy. So the consumption, if you compare with large industries, it is around 20 to 25%. So the main driver for SMEs is energy. In India, we are running a very largest and most ambitious renewable energy capacity expansion program of 450 gigawatt. There is a dedicated ministry in India for promoting renewable energy called Ministry of New and Renewable Energy. So through many initiatives, many steps, our government is taking incentivize renewable energy technologies, and also they help private sectors to go for renewable energy technologies. As of now, we are progressing with 90 gigawatt installed renewable energy in India. Through central financial assistance, our ministry is helping all renewable energy projects in solar, wind, hydro and biomass through these schemes. So SMEs can make use of these schemes and they can switch over to renewable based electricity.
Thank you. I'd like to ask one more question on the government side. Can renewable energy be sustained without government support, I wonder? Could you please share your views?
Yes, renewable energy technologies, they were very expensive, but now over a period of 3 decades, the investment cost has come down, as well as the payback period has also come down. So these technologies may not require huge capital investment, so they can sustain without government subsidies also.
Thank you very much for that. So I'd like to summarize our talk. So how exactly can greater energy efficiency and renewable energy strengthen energy security and reduce environmental problems and help achieve sustainable development?
There are many best global practices and energy efficiency technologies so far we discussed are available for industries. And also through proper integration of renewable energy technologies, energy efficient technologies, and best demand side management, and also proper planning of schemes and various government initiatives, policies. So we can definitely go for sustainable development, and these technologies will help us to become efficient economy and lead the world through sustainable growth.
Great. Thank you very much for that. With that, I'd like to thank Joel for sharing your knowledge and experience with us. And if you'd like to receive updates on future APO productivity talks, please subscribe to APO YouTube channel. And now I would like to end this talk and wish everyone stay safe and productive. Thank you and goodbye for now.
I thank APO for giving me this opportunity. I wish APO must continue to organize this kind of useful productivity talks by bringing in experts all around the world for the benefit of industries across the globe.